Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain.
Hello. A very good day to you. My name is Sister Temitayo. I'm a Christian content creator, and I'm here once again to share from the Open Heavens Daily Devotional compiled by the General Overseer of the Redeemed Christian Church of God, Pastor E.A. Adeboye. And the reason I'm sharing from this particular Christian book is because the Lord instructed me to do so as I prepare to enter into the year 2020. So this is my fourth year of sharing from the Open Heavens. That's why we call it season four. And all those videos from 2020 are all loaded on my YouTube channel. My handle on YouTube is Temi Angedo, which is right on the screen. I will encourage you to visit my channel, not only to view those old Open Heavens videos, which are a great study guide, but most importantly, to view the Open Heavens for the current day. And I know that that will bless you exceedingly. And while you're on my channel, please don't forget to subscribe, and the Lord bless you as you do. Praise God. So today is Thursday, November the 23rd, and the title of today's daily devotional is Kill That Weakness Part 2. Kill That Weakness Part 2. So we started a series yesterday titled Kill That Weakness, and it's a two-day series. We did part one yesterday, and we're doing part two today. And apart from that, I would just encourage you to visit the last 2 weeks. Just, you know, just go through all the videos. Great Christian teaching. All the topics are interwoven. I will encourage you to listen, because it will change you. And it will definitely edify you. God bless you. So today again is Thursday, November the 23rd. And we're doing Kill That Weakness Part 2. And yesterday, Pastor was talking about how we should deal with those little sins that so easily beset us, and that we should run with endurance the race that God has set before us, you know, and that we should give no place to the devil. And we're continuing with that topic this today. We're rounding up that series. Praise God. And our scripture reading for today is taken from the book of Numbers, part of the Pentateuch, the first five books of Moses. Numbers chapter 20, verses 7 to 12. That's six verses. Numbers chapter 20, that's the Old Testament, or the Pentateuch. Verses 7 to 12. And I'm going to be reading from the New King James Version. Thus goes the reading of God's word. Numbers chapter 20, verses 7 to 12. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, take the rod, you and your brother Aaron. Gather the congregation together. Speak to the rock before their eyes, and to yield its water. Thus you shall bring water for them out of the rock, and give drink to the congregation and to their animals. So Moses took the rod from before the Lord, and he commanded him. And Moses and Aaron gathered the assembly together before the rock, and he said to them, hear now, ye rebels, must we bring water for you out of this rock? Then Moses lifted his hand and struck the rock twice with his rod, and water came out abundantly, and the congregation and their animals drank. Then the Lord spake to Moses and Aaron, because you did not believe me to hallow me in the eyes of the children of Israel, therefore you shall not bring the assembly into the land which I have given them. May the Lord bless the reading of his word. So we all know the story. The first time that at the waters of Meribah, the children of Israel strove with Moses, because they said, you know, they were always complaining. They were just, you know, because God is a good God. God is long-suffering. He's good and kind. He bore with the children of Israel for years. They were unbelieving, you know, and God is long-suffering. He's great and greatly to be praised. He's a good and kind God, you know. The Bible says he has not dealt with us after our sins, and he has not punished us according to our iniquity, because if I was the one that had the chance to deal with the children of Israel, you know, I would have. But God had such mercy. He is so merciful. He's good, and his mercies endured forever. So he did not, if the Bible says, if God should mark iniquities, who will stand? You know, so these children of Israel, they got to the waters of Meribah, and, you know, when there was no water, God said to Moses to strike the rock, and that the rock will bring forth water. Then they got to this place again, and the children of Israel began to strive with Moses and Aaron, and said, why did you bring us out of Egypt? We were okay in Egypt. We're eating our leeks and our onions, and Well, okay, now you have brought us out into this wilderness, and all of us and our children to die. You promised that you're going to take us into the promised land. We have not seen any promised land flowing with milk and honey. They began to, and Moses and Aaron were so angry, and they went to the Lord. And then the Lord said to Moses, speak to the rock and it will bring you water, that the children of Israel and their congregation, they kept saying, we're tired of all this manna, this useless manna, angels' food. We're tired of this worthless manna, this, that. They complain, complain, complain. We don't have any meat. You just brought us out. Give us this. We're complaining. And not knowing that, we're complaining against Moses. We're actually complaining against God. Anyway, God the Father told Moses to speak to the rock. But he was so angry. The people had frustrated him, And then he came and he said, hear ye rebels. The Bible said they strove with Moses and Aaron. Shall we bring you water out of the rock? Instead of him to speak to the rock like God said, he struck the rock 2 times. And then the Bible tells us in the New Testament that rock he struck was Jesus Christ. Anyway, God, the water, the rock brought forth water. So even sometimes you can do something wrong and it will yield results and you think you are okay. Because when Moses struck the rock twice, water came out. But he had not done it according to the pattern that God showed him. Why? Because he was angry, And the God said to him, because you were not believing, you failed to hallow me in the sight of the children of Israel. He said to Moses and Aaron, both of you will not enter the promised land. Later we hear Moses say that that God did not allow me to enter the promised land on account of the children of Israel. And eventually also Aaron eventually died, but killed that weakness. So now the memory verse is taken from the scripture. Part of the scripture we read yesterday, Hebrews 12, when it says, wherefore, seeing that we're encompassed with so great a cloud of weaknesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily besets us, and let us run with endurance or patience the race that has been set before us. Hebrews 12, 1. Wherefore, seeing we are encompassed about by so great a cloud of weaknesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily besets us, and let us run with endurance or patience the rest that has been set before us. In other words, what he's saying is that, you see, those who have gone ahead of us, they are watching us, they are looking at our life of faith. So as we are running this race, we should lay aside every weight. Anything that wants to take you to hell, put it aside. Whatever it is that wants to hinder you from that can hinder us from seeing God, whatever it is, we should lay it aside. The sins that so easily beset us, the things that, this continued weakness, this thing, you keep falling into the same sin. And every time, we need to deal with it now by the power of the Holy Spirit. And I wish that we can run our race and finish our course like Paul, in Jesus' name. Kill that weakness, part two. I would like to give a clear illustration of what we discussed yesterday with the story of Moses. Numbers 12:3 describes Moses as the meekest man on earth, but he had a problem of anger. The devil discovered in Exodus 2:11 to 12, Moses saw an Egyptian beating up an Israelite, and because he couldn't control his temper, Moses killed the man. Many years later, while leading the children of Israel to the promised land, the devil started hitting him on this weak spot. In Exodus 14, because yesterday Pastor was saying to us about how in the boxing ring, if you go into the ring with a champion, you're looking for his weakness. So once you know his weakness, like if he has broken a limb before, that's the place you want to target. Because once you target that weakness, it will bring down that champion. Pastor said many years later, while leading the children of Israel to the promised land, the devil started hitting on this weak spot. So Moses had a problem of anger. Yesterday, I was giving a testimony of how somebody had assaulted a somebody, a lady, and he had done so to a few other women. But Satan didn't stop him until he got to the peak of his career. Then that woman came out and began to tell of the things that had happened to her. And Pastor was saying to us that sin, a man's sin will find him out. So Satan is not in a hurry. He will just allow you to keep going. You are going, 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 but he will catch you. Catch that person, at the top. And that's exactly what he did to Moses. So he knew Moses had an anger problem. And so he started, the Bible, pastor is saying here that many years later, while leading the children of Israel to the promised land, the devil started hitting in this weak spot. In Exodus 14 and 15, we see the children of Israel complaining about different things. This was the devil throwing blows at Moses to get him angry, but he dodged all of them. However, in Exodus 17, verses 1 to 7, when there was no water to drink, they turned to Moses to complain again. And he said in verse 2, "Why are you chiding with me?" The devil said, "Good blow. Number one has landed. He's now beginning to respond." In Exodus 32, verses 15 to 20, Moses had gone to collect the Ten Commandments from God. And by the time he returned, the children of Israel were already worshipping an idol. When he came and saw them worshipping the idol, the golden calf, the temper in him rose, and he took the two tablets of commandments that God gave him and smashed them. And at that point, the devil knew his punches were now landing. So all that time, the children of Israel were getting Moses irritated and getting him angry, you know, and he didn't answer them. It was Satan who was working in them. So the enemy, that's why the Bible says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and the rulers of the darkness of this world and spiritual wickedness in high places. So Moses was actually, he was looking at the children of Israel as being bad and, you know, getting him really irritated. But it wasn't them. It was Satan working in them. That's why we wrestle not against flesh and blood, you know. And, you know, at one point in time, he answered them back. So Satan knew that he was getting the victory. And then when they made the golden calf, and Moses came down from the temple with the Ten Commandments, when he saw the golden calf, the Bible says his anger waxed hot. And he broke the Ten Commandments. And Satan knew he had gotten him. In Numbers 11, 10, 15, when the children of Israel were complaining that they wanted meat, Moses turned to God and said, "God, why are you doing this to me? Am I the father of these people?" And the devil said, "Good, now I have turned you against your supporter." By the time we get to Numbers 20, verses 2 to 3, the people murmured again about water. But this time, instead of speaking to the rock as God commanded, Moses was so angry that he hit it twice. He hit the rock twice. And God asked him to speak to the rock, but he decided to strike it. And that was counted to him as disobedience. At that point, the Almighty God said to Moses, "You will not reach the promised land." So you see, what Satan is trying to do is to get us to offend God. You know, because you see, he began to push Moses. Moses broke the Ten Commandments in his anger. And then the devil entered into the children of Israel again, and they began to chide with Moses at the rock. So he was so angry. Instead of speaking to the rock, he struck it twice. And God said, because you failed to, you know, God said to when Nadab and Abihu, when they were killed, he said, "Before I must be regarded as holy, before all the children, children of Israel, I must be glorified," you know. And so God said, Moses, so the aim of Satan was to turn Moses against God, to do make Moses do something that would make God punish him. And that's exactly, you see, that anger pushed him. He made a mistake. And he offended God. He committed a sin, and God punished him for it, because God expects him that at that level he should have been able to control his anger. The meek Moses, with only one little contamination called anger, had become, after 40 years of ministry, a failure. Beloved, kill that little weakness in your life before it kills you. The key point is, kill that little weakness in your life before it kills you. May God have mercy on us. So you see, Satan attacked Moses and he hindered him from entering the promised land. But God had mercy on him. You know, God had mercy on him. He said, in all, God said about Moses that there's not faithful in all my house like Moses, one with whom I speak face to face. You know, but he that little weakness nearly destroyed him. Thank God for his mercy. He would have missed it. You know, so, and pastor said we should kill that little weakness before it kills us. And I was saying yesterday that you need to identify that weakness. Because when Satan wants to, you see, like, David had a problem of lust, you know, and when he saw that woman bathing, well, the woman wasn't the problem, you know. The judge shall live by his own faith. David should have controlled himself. So we can't say, "Oh, Bathsheba, why Sheba?" She has a problem. She was baffling for everyone to see. But then David had the responsibility of controlling himself and turning his eyes away. So he had a problem of loss. He slept with Bathsheba. And then he tried to cover up the sins. That's what I was saying yesterday, that Satan, He's not coming to attack you with that one sin of anger or that one sin of lust. He has other things in mind. Other sins will follow that one. And so David had a problem of lust that led to murder. And then he began to lie again, you know. And, you know, it led to the splitting of the house of Israel. You know, so Pastor says we should kill that little weakness in our lives before it kills us. And I said prayer, you know, praying in the Holy Ghost nonstop. Pray without ceasing. You know, it's a habit we have to form, and the Spirit of God helps us to pray in the Holy Ghost without ceasing. And we must be as wise as serpents, as subtle as doves. We must be very, very careful. The people we move around with, you know, the people we hang out with, we must make sure that we deal with that weakness, confront it with the Word of God, confront it with the Spirit of God. We must hide ourselves under the shadow of the Almighty, you know, and, you know, the Spirit of God helps us in our weaknesses. In the name of Jesus Christ, let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you. We ask that you help us, O God, in the mighty name of Jesus. Every little living, Almighty God, every little fox, every seed of sin that wants to resurrect again, Father, we ask that you destroy it by the fire of your Holy Spirit in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord Jesus Christ, you say you baptize us with the Holy Ghost and with fire, and that you burn up every shaft with unquenchable fire. Lord Jesus, every sin that so easily besets us, Almighty God, let it be consumed by the fire of God in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Lord, expose every hidden weakness, Almighty God, in our lives in the name of Jesus Christ. Consume them with the spirit of your mouth. Destroy those weaknesses with the brightness of your coming in the mighty name of Jesus. And help us, Son of God, help us, Lord Jesus Christ, to stand perfect and complete in all the will of God in Jesus' name. Thank you, Holy Ghost. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much for taking time to listen to me. I hope this blessed you. And while you're on my channel, please don't forget to subscribe, and the Lord bless you as you do. And I give you permission to share this video on your social media platforms. The Lord bless you. I look forward to seeing you tomorrow. My name again is Sister Temi Tayo. And please don't forget to subscribe. God bless you. See you tomorrow.